Good morning. My name is Giselle Warton, and I work at the UCT Safety and Violence Initiative and the UCT Sexual Assault Response Team. And I'm going to be chairing the panel session today. And the panel session today is on the topic of addressing and preventing gender-based violence in South Africa. The first presentation will be by Marike Keller, and she'll be speaking about new strategies to engage government in search of significant resources to end gender-based violence. Marike Keller is the Policy Development and Advocacy Coordinator for Sonke Gender Justice, and her work focuses on gender-based violence. Her work covers research, analysis, and policy reform on gender-based violence, and as well as supporting the campaign for a national strategic plan on gender-based violence. And then the next speaker is Shahana Rasool, and she'll be speaking on the role of family and friends in either preventing or perpetuating violence against women. Shahana Rasool is a lecturer at the Department of Social Work at the University of Johannesburg, and she has been working in the field of violence against women for 20 years. She first worked as a student, looked at the issue of sexual harassment in university settings, and she has also worked in the NGO sector as a researcher and trainer, and her PhD focused on women's help-seeking behavior after domestic violence. And her current work focuses on adolescent experiences of and witnessing gender-based violence. And then next will be Naeemah Abrams from the Gender Health Research Unit of the South African Medical Research Council. And she's going to be looking at the intersectionality of gender and disability in the violent experiences of women with physical disabilities in South Africa. Naeemah Abrams is the Deputy Director of the Gender and Health Research Unit of the Medical Research Council, and her research focuses include gender-based violence and the interface between this and HIV. She also does a lot of work on intimate partner violence, and this includes a range of topics such as men as perpetrators, risk factors for perpetrating intimate partner violence, the role of guns in gender-based violence, and health sector responses to gender-based violence. And then our fourth presenter is Dane Isaacs, and he will be speaking on social representations of intimate partner violence in the Western Cape media. Dane is a junior researcher in the Human and Social Development Unit at the Human Sciences Research Council. He holds a master's degree in research psychology from the University of Cape Town, and his research interests include the constructions of masculinity amongst disabled men in South Africa and violence against women. He specifically looks at men's perpetration of violence against women partners. And before joining the Human Sciences Research Council, Dane worked as a counselor with recovering addicts at the First Community Resource Center in Hanover Park. So how this session is going to work is that we're going to have Marike speak for about 12 minutes, and then we're going to have a 5-minute question and answer session with her because she has to leave early. And then following that, we're just going to have all three presentations and then question and answer session. Our fourth presenter, Dane, has asked that I mention that he has a slight speech difficulty. So if you could be patient, and when we do the question and answer session, if we could just write down the questions. Yeah. Okay, so over to Marike Keller on new strategies to engage government in search of significant resources to end gender-based violence.
Okay. Thanks, Giselle, for that introduction. So as Giselle has mentioned, I work for Sonke Gender Justice, a human rights organization working across Africa to strengthen civil society and government and citizen capacity to promote gender equality and an end to domestic violence and sexual violence. Today, however, I will be presenting on behalf of the Stop Gender Violence campaign, which is a national campaign comprised of 38 civil society organizations across the country advocating for an end to gender-based violence, and more specifically, a fully funded, multi-sectoral, national strategic plan on gender-based violence as a roadmap to accomplish an end to gender-based violence. Today, I will be talking about engaging government in new strategies to address gender-based violence. I will do this by starting with an overview of GBV and a situational analysis thereof in the country, followed by government processes and how best to fit gender-based violence into these. The Department of Social Development will be used as an example thereof, and I will then end with ways forward. The Stop Gender Violence campaign has come up with a very simple definition of gender-based violence. We've decided to define GBV as violence against another person because of their gender. It can be physical, sexual, psychological, economic, or cultural. While GBV is largely experienced as violence against women, it affects all people, including men, lesbian, gay, bisexual, transgender, intersex, and queer people. GBV is a violation of a person's basic human rights, as well as the South African constitutional rights to dignity and safety. This iceberg graph, developed by the Institute for Social Security Studies, provides a great snapshot of gender-based violence statistics. South Africa is faced with staggeringly high rates of GBV. For the year 2014-15, 43,196 sexual offences were reported, and 161,486 common assaults were reported. While a very small reduction has been seen from previous years in terms of reported cases, it is too early to celebrate, as this isn't reflective of the actual incidences of GBV that are occurring. So the ISS estimates that only about 1 in 13 rapes is reported, and that only 46% of assault victims report this abuse to police. Thus, the statistics don't paint a pretty or reflective picture when it comes to violence in our country. In 2014, KPMG developed a report indicating that gender-based violence cost the South African economy between 28.4 billion and 42.4 billion rand. That is over 1%. Of our gross domestic product. It must be noted as well, though, that one of the limitations of this report, which they've also indicated, is that this figure excludes the cost of pain and suffering, lost tax revenues, hiring and training replacement staff, the cost of private healthcare, and the cost of volunteers' time. They also note that it is a very, very conservative estimate of the actual cost, and that the real cost could be billions of rands higher. To address the scourge of GBV, South Africa has adopted a number of progressive laws, such as the Sexual Offences Act of 2007 and the Domestic Violence Act of 1998. Moreover, it's also developed a number of plans in the past in an attempt to address gender-based violence. For example, the 365-day National Action Plan to End Gender Violence and the Integrated Program of Action Addressing Violence Against Women and Children. However, these have been fragmented and unsuccessful for myriad reasons, including that they weren't costed and thus not budgeted for, the lack of intersectoral consultations, and the lack of implementation. As such, a coalition of civil society organizations have taken on the task to advocate for an intersectoral, consultative, and costed national strategic plan on gender-based violence. Additionally, the coalition have started exploring alternative ways and alternative pathways to ensure that gender-based violence becomes a government priority by looking more closely at government processes and how best to fit gender-based violence into these. After government elections, the government creates a 5-year planning framework called the Medium-Term Strategic Framework. From this framework, each department must develop their own 5-year strategic plan, which links to this MTSF framework, which links to the broader NDP. From this, they must then develop a plan of activities on an annual basis, and this is called the Annual Performance Plan. Each annual performance plan has a list of programs with specific objectives, key performance indicators, and planned targets for the year ahead. The strategic plans and the APPs specifically are costed and budgeted for. This is reflected in the annual estimates of national expenditure. Therefore, for budget to be created for an objective, the needs need to be clearly stated in both the strategic plan and the annual performance plan. As such, it is important for gender-based violence to be represented in departmental strategic plans and their annual performance plans to ensure that budget is created to address this. GBV cuts across many departments, as services and responses are mandated within different departments. However, the Department of Social Development is the lead department on GBV following various departmental shifts in 2014. As such, the Department of Social Development is the first department chosen by the Stop Gender Violence campaign to analyze its strategic plan and its annual performance plan to assess to what extent the department is committed to addressing gender-based violence. The DSD's strat plan is very broad and very ambitious. When it comes to GBV, however, minimal provision has been made for it. The strat plan has 5 overarching programs, and gender-based violence falls into program 4, which is called the Welfare Services Policy Development and Implementation Support. And it has 2 baseline indicators mentioning gender-based violence. The first is an integrated program of action addressing violence against women and children. And the second indicator is a functional command center. There is no further information on any of this in the strat plan. The Department of Social Development's annual performance plan, which is a more specific annual portrayal of the department's objectives, reveals the following commitment to GBV. Just over $500 million is allocated to program 4 as a whole. No specific budget is mentioned for GBV. And given the broad focus of Program 4, it is unlikely that it's sufficient. Only 1 high-level output is mentioned in the APP, namely, South African Integrated Program of Action Addressing Violence Against Women and Children is implemented. This in itself is extremely vague and much too broad, and the performance indicators meant to measure this output, of which there are only 2, are themselves problematic. The indicators are first, number of GBV victims accessing GBV command center, and 2, number of white door safe spaces established. These indicators aren't reflective of the integrated program of action as a whole, which itself has over 58 indicators. As such, it's inaccurate to state that the IPA, or the integrated program of action, has been implemented, given that the 2 indicators of this aren't reflective thereof. Moreover, the indicators are not adequately addressing the complexity of gender-based violence. And last, there is no allocated budget specific to these indicators. By including gender-based violence in departmental strat plans and annual performance plans, it ensures that government can be held accountable and provides adequate budget for GBV. This research is also just the beginning, and an exploration by the SGV campaign is ongoing into finding new ways in which to ensure that adequate resources are made available and allocated to GBV. As such, and because GBV cuts across so many different departments, research into strat plans and APPs of various other departments are in the process of being conducted, with the intention of drafting and providing collaborative input for these departments. Moreover, this research feeds into the campaign's overarching demand for a national strategic plan on gender-based violence by providing a streamlined process which contributes towards the roadmap that a national strategic plan would provide. Thank you.
Okay, so we're just going to have 5 minutes for questions and answers for Marike, because she has to leave early. So are there any questions? Anybody have a question? Yes.
I'm just wondering how, in terms of sort of situating funding for shelters and organizations working on violence against women, is it funded through social work posts, for example? Where does that fit into, or how does it fit into the funding by DSD on gender-based violence?
Any more questions? Okay, Naeemah.
Much for that presentation. It's long past due for us to respond. I wanted to ask about data, collecting data, in order for a plan to know whether a plan works and to know whether monitoring information. Is there any evidence that somebody is responsible for monitoring whether the interventions are effective, whether there's decrease, whether there's increase? Just wanted to know where does data, with data house, if it is at all.
Okay. Maybe one question. Okay.
Hi, Marike. I just wanted to ask about these white door safe spaces. How many are there? Do you have that kind of information?
Thanks for those questions. So for the first question, where shelters fit into the funding by DSD, that is in, of the five programs, that would be under one of the other programs. So I focus specifically on program four because that's where GBV is housed. However, the shelters don't fall under the ambit of GBV. And specific funding for that, there weren't specific budget lines for that either. In the APPs, they kind of give broad overviews of, here's some money for this program, but they don't say how much is going to go for the training of social workers or shelters or anything like that. So it's very difficult to ascertain how much is being allocated for those. Then collecting data and monitoring. This is an ongoing problem within the sector. We know that there is a lot of underreporting happening, so it's difficult to get accurate or reflective statistics. The police and Stats SA do release annual statistics, and then the Medical Research Council, I know that they also, I think their stat is that, for example, rapes are underreported by 1 in 9, so for each rape that is reported, you should expect that it's 9 times higher, and the ISS estimate that it's 13 times higher even. So As a campaign, we look at those statistics as well. So while we say that Stats SA or police have reported just over 43,000 sexual offences cases, we do know that it's between 9 and 13 times higher than that. In terms of monitoring, the Shukumisa campaign monitors the sexual offences specifically, and a number of the organisations that are part of our campaign are also part of the Shukumisa campaign, and we are collaborating with them in terms of monitoring statistics on sexual offences as well. I hope that kind of answers. Okay. The white door spaces, how many? They aren't that many yet. So in the annual performance plan, they have indicated that for each quarter they would like to have about 5 more built. But when looking at the annual report, there is no evidence yet of them having actually built these white spaces, and they haven't indicated where they're going to be building them, and there is actually not much information to be found on this. So that is one thing that, as a campaign, we're also monitoring the annual report to then also hold them accountable to what they have in their APPs, and then compare that to the annual report and find the differences of what they've actually done and from what they've promised. So that's one way in which we're holding them accountable as well.
Thank you, Marike. Shahana Rasool from the Department of Social Work at the University of Johannesburg is now going to be speaking on the role of family and friends in either preventing or perpetuating violence against women.
Good morning, everybody, and thank you to Giselle. And thanks so much, Marike, for that presentation. It was fascinating coming from the Department of Social Work, because it always worries me that the Department of Social Development is just really not doing what it should be around the issues of gender-based violence. But today my paper is focusing on the role of family and friends in dealing with domestic violence. And what I want to argue in this paper is that the responses of informal networks were paradoxical to women in either inhibiting women's help-seeking or facilitating them escaping domestic violence by connecting them with services. So in the first instance, the majority of responses by informal networks sanctioned, tolerated, or allowed abuse to pass due to acquiescence with social-cultural discourses that suggest abuse is a private matter, it should be normalized, or the acceptance of abuse. And this served to reinforce abused women's marginal position in the family. Okay. On the other hand, supportive informal networks played a role in assisting women becoming agents of change and attaining empowerment through helping them seek assistance. Okay. So what I'm arguing, which was what Mo suggests, is that one helpful response may spur further help-seeking efforts. It may also legitimize a woman's claim to other agencies. Just as failed help-seeking may be cumulative in effect, so too might successful help-seeking. Okay. And because of just to say that informal networks refers to family, parents, mothers-in-law, siblings, other relatives, friends, neighbors, and community members. Okay. And because of time constraints, I have the methodology and I have the description of the participants, but I'm not going to go through that. But just to say that they were women who were in Joburg and Cape Town shelters, so they're women who had sought help, because I wanted to understand what were the constraints in help-seeking, what facilitated help-seeking, okay? So what I'm wanting to spend my time on is to argue this case that professionals, mental health workers, criminal justice officials, and the community, we really need to work with family and friends to change these social cultural norms that perpetuate violence. And secondly, in how we respond, or how family and friends respond to abused women, because these responses are critical for managing domestic violence effectively and quickly. Okay. So the first part of my paper will provide evidence about how family and friends responded, which was negative, and the second part will talk about how they facilitated help seeking, which is around tertiary prevention. So historically, it has been argued that domestic violence is a private matter because it happens behind closed doors. However, evidence from various studies in South Africa has shown that domestic violence is happening in public and semi-public domains, and that despite adults witnessing domestic violence or being aware of its occurrence, because they are told by victims, those who know do not intervene. Non-interference is justified through arguments that domestic violence is a private matter that should be resolved by the two individuals concerned. So Lisa, first participant, a young African woman who lived in a communal township in Langebaan in Cape Town, that said that she was not helped by those in her environment because they saw it as private. She says, nobody helped me. The entire time I stayed with him, he was choking me. I'm screaming for help. They see he's hitting and stabbing me, and nobody tried to help me. Similarly, Polina's case the neighbors witnessed the husband nearly throwing her over a balcony, and she said, those that saw, they did nothing. Jamina said, I used to scream. Nobody wanted to help me. We lived in three blocks. Everybody could see what's happening. So these interviews indicate that knowledge of abuse by community members and bystanders is widespread, but actions to assist them is scant. So although abuse is public knowledge, in this way not private, the view that others should not interfere perpetuates the social belief of privacy in the home, family. So this tolerance of domestic violence and bystanders discourages women from seeking help and contributes to their reluctance to seek formal help. The interviews also indicated that not only were community members aware of abuse, but family members as well. They spoke about of instances where they told their sisters who were aware of the abuse but didn't intervene. So Fatima states, my elder sister knew, she didn't do anything. So for other, I'm not gonna go through all the quotes, so you can just read them. For other participants, abuse happened in full view of family members who were unresponsive. In Shamima's case, abuse happened in front of the extended family during a function. Her family took no active steps to assist her, to stop the beating, she relates. His cousins and aunts were all there. They were just sitting in the lounge and thinking, how can he hit her like that? But they didn't do anything. They just sat there. Shamima felt a profound sense of abandonment by her family, who did nothing to stop the violence or to refer her for help after. In Irene's situation, while her husband was beating her, her brother-in-law walked in and asked him what he was doing, and he told him to mind his own business, which is what he did. So non-interference due to notions that abuse is a private matter seems to have been striking in the lack of intervention by family. This was particularly stark in Shanaz's situation where her own mother was aware of the abuse, but she did not respond. I was screaming and shouting, but they never came. My mother didn't come. My eldest brother was there, but they just accepted the abuse. I don't know why. So in many cases, this inaction of people close to the survivor is debilitating and weakens their resolve to seek further help from formal services. It seems as though they felt if their own families wouldn't help them, why would anyone else assist them? So this extent of compliance of various family members with abuse reinforces a patriarchal system that colludes with notions of male ownership over their partners. In many situations, it seems that family, friends prefer to do nothing or berate women for seeking help from formal services, as some of my other data illustrates. So in some cases, women report abuse to older women who normalized it by reflecting that they too had personally experienced abuse. This intergenerational tolerance of abuse seems to underlie its acceptability in families and communities, as highlighted in Catherine's case. She said, when Catherine told her mother-in-law who witnessed her abuse, she said she was laughing and says, he hits me just like your father hit me, like his father hit me, sorry. Similarly, Paulina's mother minimized abuse and said, ah, it's nothing, look at my body. You see, the man I was living with, he used to stab me. So being told by the older generation of women that they too had experienced abuse highlights the acceptability of it, and this convinced women that there's no recourse for dealing with domestic violence. Some abuse women reported to their mother-in-laws, who reinforced the patriarchal order that legitimated and normalized domestic violence, rather than assisting women. In Rihanna's case, her abusive partner made her leave her job so she could become financially dependent on him. When she disclosed this to her mother-in-law, she invoked the rights of men to act with impunity by virtue of their gender. She says, I do everything what he did, but still he beat me. And his mother says, well, a married man can do whatever he feels like. Similarly, the mothers-in-law of the other woman not only underscored the rights of men to control women, but also blamed the daughter-in-laws for the abuse. Nita says, sometimes she blames me. She thinks I must do whatever he wants. In these situations, mother-in-laws would do whatever they could to isolate women by preventing them from having contact with other people. In some cases, they not only contributed to the isolation of women, they actually contributed to the violence as well, or encouraged the violence. So in Shamima's case, her mother-in-law encouraged his son to beat his wife to ensure her obedience, since she was challenging his authority. So Shamima says, according to his mummy, he has to discipline me He had to hit me. He needs to discipline me because under no circumstances shall I talk to him that way. I shouldn't tell him what to say. So the notion that if women are considered cheeky, opinionated, or question the views or lifestyles of men, they need to be beaten into submission is not uncommon in communities where domestic violence is rife. So despite extensive evidence that there's a lack of support from family and friends, there were instances in which informal networks were able to provide abused women with support by listening to them, assisting them with material resources such as food or accommodation, and referring them or even physically escorting them to formal services. This is really important since several abused women in this study did not have knowledge of shelters, which are vital resources if they had to successfully deal with abusive relationships. Abused women find out about shelters through random encounters with informal networks during times of desperation. The role of information and support provided by informal networks is pivotal to women escaping abuse. So in this section, I talk about the critical moments or turning points for women's agency and resulting empowerment. So Rihanna says, when she went to her friend, it made the difference to her survival, mostly when she listened to her. Okay. Another participant said, when she felt most helped, she said, when the time when I talked to his mother and when I was here at the shelter, I had a chance to speak about everything. In Irene's case, her mother-in-law confronting the abuser, it was important to her sense of being helped. And similarly for some of the other women, talking to people in the environment who helped them was very important. I'm just worried about time. 2 minutes, thanks. Okay. So in cases where women did receive such help from informal networks, they sought formal resources. In some cases, they were even empowered to escape abuse. This is important since women lack knowledge of the role of social services in helping them deal with domestic violence. And informal networks are an important source of information to refer them to appropriate formal resources. Many of the women in the study didn't really know about shelters. They knew about shelters for children or homeless people, but they didn't necessarily know about shelters for abused women. And if they did, they didn't necessarily know of how to access them or what kind of support they would get when they went there. So there were a couple of women who talk about shelters and how they found out about shelters, and also about how some finding out through random encounters with strangers where they shared their stories and they got information either about organizations that could help by going to the mosque, or the one woman's, someone referred her to someone at the ANC's Women's Rights Center who then referred her on. So it's this process of help seeking is actually quite long for women. And the referrals from informal resources become really important, but sometimes it's after a very long time, okay? What I want to do is just move to my conclusion, since my time is almost up, which really talks to the importance of informal support networks in enabling women to seek help, okay? And so on the one hand, when informal resources do not respond appropriately to women, they don't seek help or are more reluctant to go to formal services and it takes them longer to get there. On the other hand, when they get referred, this allows them to access help and leave the abuse relationship. Okay. And so this really, it's important that we understand that in South Africa, domestic violence is actually not as hidden as we think it is. But there's a sense of normalization and that men are allowed to act with impunity. And that whilst we have lots of institutional and legislative changes, I don't think we've taken family members and communities and friends along with us in terms of helping them to support women get out of domestic violence situations. And then I think the long-term message is also about prevention. How do we work with children and young people to look at changing these gender attitudes and social cultural norms that perpetuate gender-based violence? Thank you.
Thank you so much. Next, we're going to have Naeemah Abrams from the Gender and Health Research Unit, and she's going to be speaking about the intersections of gender and disability and the violence experiences of women with physical disabilities in South Africa.
Good morning, everybody. So I'm actually speaking on behalf of Ingrid van der Heide. This is Ingrid's PhD project, and I am supervising her through it. Actually, at the moment, Ingrid is with researchers from the Middle East actually taking the study and training them to do a similar study in other parts of the globe. So that's exciting. I thought it was important for her to attend that and to train others. So she was very good. She prepared me in very deep, great detail the presentation. So disability is no longer just focus on a person's or individual's impairments. It's really a social construct. It's about the disabling physical, social, and political environments that marginalize people from full participation in society. So the intersections of gender, race, and ethnicity and class further exaggerates this marginalization. So what disables people is how society responds to them. Globally, people with disabilities experience stigma, discrimination, poor access to health and justice services, and physical and communication barriers. And because of this, they are marginalized. They're poorer, they're less educated, they're less employed, and they have poorer access to services, health services, and compared to the general population. So gender now adds a further burden, as women are more marginalized than men, as we've heard throughout the time. So a meta-analysis in The Lancet in 2012 revealed that 50% of people with disabilities experience violence in the past year. So that's incidents in the past year. Women with disability are doubly at risk for violence because of the disability stigma, gender power relations, and are more likely, as I said earlier, to be marginalized because of education and poverty. Women with disabilities are often assumed also to be asexual. They're unable to produce, to reproduce, unable to feel sexual pleasures, and assumed less likely to have an intimate partner. So often intimate partner remains hidden amongst these women. Knowing that violence is a common feature here in South Africa, and it's profoundly gendered, as we've heard throughout the 2 days, women exposed to high rates of intimate partner violence, rape, and as well as femicide, it remains important for us to really understand the situation of women with disabilities in our country, and including understanding the additional risks and vulnerabilities. And we need to integrate these into our national policies and NGO services, as well as prevention interventions. So the research was done, a qualitative study was done. Ingrid interviewed 30 women here in the Western Cape. Women were recruited from disabled organizations, protective workshops. These are workshops disabled women attend to build their skills. And she also accessed people in residential care facilities. I just want to say she also interviewed men, not just women, but this paper is just about the woman, the data from the woman. The participants were made aware of the risk and benefits of participating. The ethics of working with disabled people are obviously different, and it's a lot exaggerated. And so consent procedures and understanding what it means to participate in the study was something she gave lots of attention to. And in fact, she has now written, starting to write guidelines on how to do research with disabled people. But her basic framework was using the WHO guidelines that we did for violence against women previously. So, Census 2011 reveals that about 7.5% of the population here in South Africa are living with a disability, with the majority being Black African people, generally living in poverty, with barriers accessing services, with Black disabled women needing the most economic empowerment. Our participants were largely African-colored, women aged between the ages of 19 and 54 years, all receive a government disability grant. They had a range of sensory and physical impairments, including mobility, sight, and hearing impairments. We excluded women with cognitive impairments or intellectual disabilities, even though they are way more vulnerable. And I know it's an area that we do need to think about, how do we understand the experiences of violence. The woman lived in peri-urban informal settlements around Cape Town metropole, which was characterized, as we know, by poverty, informal housing, shacks, which typifies a lack of infrastructure and poor access to basic services, high unemployment rates, high crime, alcoholism, and substance abuse. These informal structures were generally erected on uneven ground, making navigating with assistive devices very difficult. Shacks also provided minimal protection for women from the cold, gave them little or no privacy from other households members, and no security against crime. Women spoke of their difficulties fetching and carrying water to wash with, and their difficulties accessing the communal toilets. These living and residential care facilities explained that because of their physical needs and mobility challenges, living in an informal shack was not an option for them. So many women who had not completed their secondary education or gained formal employment because accessibility issues particularly were reliable on transport and to get to and from school or to work. So basically, our aim was to describe a woman with physical and sensory disabilities exposure to different forms of violence throughout their lifetime. So we asked them about the experiences when they were children as well. So this briefly gives you an overview of the type of violence that women spoke about and the number. It's qualitative, we can't really apply percentages, but it gives you an overview of the different forms of violence that these women experience. And you'll also see that it actually goes beyond the normal physical, sexual. We have to talk about neglect and deprivation as part of the experiences of violence on a daily basis. So if we look at psychological abuse, what's the most prevalent form of violence that these women's narratives, what that came across in the narratives of throughout their lifetime? And it took the form of verbal abuse and name calling that resulted in women being belittled, humiliated, worthless. Since they were young, women had been called dehumanizing names such as a monkey, a creature, and were labeled a punishment, unable to do anything, or not right in their head, or were called dumb, useless, or a fool, insinuating that they were mentally impaired. A few of the partnered women spoke about emotional abuse from their partners, from the in-laws, who brand them incapable of being suitable partners or wives for their sons, or refused to pay labola. They would say, they do not see me as a wife. A mother told the participant she couldn't have a baby, as she couldn't even look after herself, insinuating she was a child herself and were unable to be a mother. One woman was a paraplegia in a wheelchair, was questioned why she was applying for a house. You can't even walk or help yourself. Why do you need a house? This is from service providers. After being raped, a young woman in a wheelchair was shunned by healthcare workers for being pregnant, and who also interrogated her ability to have sex or to become pregnant, and said, even when I went to have my abortion, I went to this one hospital, and the nurse says to the other nurse, how did you get pregnant? I didn't know you could do it in wheelchairs. Okay, let me fly through it. So financial abuse was very closely linked to the disability grant that they received. It put them at additional financial abuse, being extorted, especially in the context where there is poverty. Family members, partners would control their access to their grants. They would also threaten to use violence, and the young woman claimed that men would often date them because of the grant. Physical abuse, physical violence often precipitated by or occurred together with many other forms of violence. During their childhood, women reported receiving beatings by teachers, parents, or caregivers because they were slow. or had wet or soiled themselves. Mostly women felt they were easy targets for everyday crimes such as thefts and muggings because of their impairments. They would often be targeted in their homes or while out in the community. Neglect and deprivation. From early in their lives, women experienced multiple forms of neglect and deprivation. Some were reported about being left at home without people to assist them, to feed them, or to use a toilet. Partners refusing to assist them in transporting them to work or to buy groceries. Some spoke about how partners would hide them because of shame and embarrassment and only take them out at night and only show affection to them when in private and not in public. Care facility staff often said to deprive women of their autonomy and neglect their care needs. Residents said staff ignored their requests for privacy when dressing or using the bathroom, or often left residents cold or semi-dressed and hungry. This woman also talked about how there were facility policies where they were not allowed to have relationships with co-residents. Sexual violence. Women spoke mostly of the wide range of unwanted sexual behavior that occurred during their lifetime, including fondling, forced oral and anal sex, non-consensual sexual intercourse. Some of these events occurring early years of their lives, the perpetrators were all male. 9 participants described the first sexual experience as coerced. Women were left alone at home, particularly when they were young. Some experienced being forcefully kissed, raped by men that were able to come inside. A blind woman said, "I didn't see him enter. I didn't know who he was. I shouted out for him to leave." A quadriplegic said, "He came in and he knew there was no one there. He pulled me from my wheelchair, pushed me on the ground, and he did that thing. And afterwards, I was lying on the ground." A woman with cerebral palsy reported that when having sex with her boyfriend, he would flip around and have anal sex with her. She would cry, and she says that she never liked it. An amputee experienced forced oral sex by a male care facility staff member who was looking after her. Right. I will move on to the discussion where we just want to say that this study supports the findings from the international literature that violence against women with disabilities happens out of sight. And that it certainly is a problem. We're just not looking for it. We're not asking for it. We need to think about how it happens within the home as well as in care facilities. We need to think about how we construct women with disabilities and don't think of them as a child. For women partners, what I didn't talk about here is about how women might prefer in some cases to have disabled men as well because they felt that they understood their situation, but then there were others that said able-bodied men could help them again. So for women, there were different experiences. I think what's important is for us to think about, I'm going to end off here, to think about how we need to include this within our policies, within our services, and in our measurement of violence against women. Because the measurement scores we would use here, for example, would be about neglect. It would be about violence of having your assistance, your crutches taken away, your wheelchair taken away. And those are things that hasn't really been developed in our ways in which we ask about violence amongst disabled people. I also want to say that we've got a broader set of data where we spoke to men as well. Violence certainly happened to disabled men as well. And I hope I've done justice to Ingrid's paper. There's so much more. She's got such rich data. That's the paper where you can find all of this that was published earlier in this year. Thanks.
Thank you. Now we're going to have Dane Isaacs, who's going to be speaking on social representations of intimate partner violence in the Western Cape media.
Good morning. Hi. So this actually formed part of my master's research. And I would actually like to start off in saying, you know, that I am a stutterer, and that I mean that it will take a bit of time for me to get through this. So just be patient with me. Thank you. Thanks. Thank you so much. Yeah. So basically, the study was important on two levels. You know, the first thing is that intimate partner violence is one of the leading causes of death amongst women in South Africa presently. And secondly, the South African media has been recognized as playing an important role in constructing individuals' perceptions of social issues, including intimate partner violence. Well, this said, though, however, there's been actually a few studies that has actually looked at how this violence comes to be represented within the South African media. I'll go past the aims and I'll go to the research questions because it speaks to the same thing. So these were the two research questions that I focused on. What were the social representations of intimate partner violence that had emerged in the Western Cape media? And then I also focused on also the implications of these representations. It was a qualitative study. It doesn't get to move. The slide is not moving. Could you just please, thanks. Thank you, sure. Thank you so much. Yeah, so, like I focused on the Daily Voice, the Cape Argus, and the Cape Times, and I found newspaper articles, you know, that made particular reference, you know, to the topic of intimate partner violence perpetrated by male partners against female partners. The data analysis was Braun and Clark's thematic analysis. The themes that emerged were the social representations of IPV as a problem of the justice system, of victim blaming and perpetrator sympathy as the problem of the male partner. I mean, same thing. And then also as an extreme act of physical violence. However, I'll just be focusing on the second and third theme for the discussion. So this was a prominent finding at the media would oftentimes blame the female victim for the violence. So a perfect example was the Oscar and Riva coverage. So there was an article that focused on Riva's actual lack of fear, and in fact, what the journalist did, the journalist centered Oscar's anger around that affair, and I think on the next page, Oscar was described as extremely helpless and fragile and in need of the public's support. And then in contrast though, to American literature, which was very interesting, is that the media would oftentimes use the quotes of relatives and also other professionals to draw sympathy to the perpetrator. Then in stark contrast, the male perpetrator's violence, was particularly constructed as the aftermath of substance abuse and a mental breakdown. And at the same time, it was also constructed as a negative outcome of poor impulse control, uncontrollable jealousy, and a violent temper. My conclusion is that unfortunate, the Western Cape media are still largely promote distorted portrayals of intimate partner violence to its readers. But with this said, under the media also, they also have the power to, a solution. So, thank you.
Thank you so much. Okay, so now we're going to have questions We're going to have about 4 or 5 questions, and then if there's, we'll do the answers, and then if there's extra time, we can do another round of questions. Yeah. So, questions. Okay, can we start that side, or? Well, you vote first, so.
Good morning. My question is directed at Professor, I think, Abrahams and Ingrid, and firstly, maybe even to thank you for actually conducting research in a very sensitive area. We know for a fact that really engaging with people with disabilities is not easy. So I think basically, you know, the work that you have done is very much appreciated. And maybe I'm Sina from UNICEF. But I want to find out from you as to whether, as you engaged with the women with disabilities, especially where they shared their, you know, experiences, you know, did they come up with an indication from their perspective as to how best can actually their protection be optimized, rather than us thinking for them, and rather than maybe in addition, you know, of course they will always talk about dealing with stigma that we always, you know, sort of that they always experience, but were there other things that they shared as to actually how best, you know, their protection can be optimized? And I also want to find out, as researchers, when you were interviewing them, you know, one can already see that they were actually offloading quite a lot of their experiences. Were there any alternatives made, you know, for their further support, you know, based on, you know, engaging with them and therefore now triggering that emotional kind of, you know, conversation where they further then, you know, referred for support, counseling and support. Thank you.
thank you. My name is Tulim Tetwa. I'm from Project Memeza. It's a police pro-activation project. My comment rather is to Dane. It's not a comment. It's a thank you. It takes a lot of courage to do what you do. And remember that Moses in the Bible, he was like you, he was stammering, but he took the Israelites out of Egypt and he did great things. And I just want to say to you, you are not doing this by yourself, you are not you alone. It's someone from high above that sent you to do this. And thank you so much, the presentation was wonderful, thank you.
Thank you. My question is to Shahana. I'm Lauren October from SaVI. I actually just wanted to find out if you discovered anything in your research or if any of your respondents mentioned the pivotal role that religious institutions play in women abuse, and the fact that they can either exacerbate the idea that wives belong to their husbands and, you know, family members shouldn't get involved, or the, you know, the potential that they have for inspiring these informal networks to actually intervene when they witness the abuse. Just did anybody mention anything, or did you find anything? Thank you.
Thank you so much. My name is Karen Reese from an organization called Mosaic here in the Western Cape. My question is also for Shahana. Around the informal networks, I know that the research looked at the role of family and friends in either preventing or perpetuating the violence. But I also saw, in terms of the informal networks, there was also mention of family and friends. So I'm just wondering what those informal networks look like that women are using. And I ask that from a programmatic point of view of how we can better use those informal networks to promote accessing formal services.
So thank you very much for that question. So yes, so there was data. So the woman that was interviewed come from different contexts. And I think those who were, for example, in care centers talked a lot about how the policies in the care centers could change and improve. they talk a lot about the autonomy being taken away in those care centers. So each, because it was qualitative, each one had a different context. So a woman living with a wheelchair in a shack area, for her it's very difficult to negotiate, and she has to be dependent on her mother's boyfriend, who then sexually abused her. So yes, they said, just being listened to, I'm sure Ingrid wouldn't mind. Ingrid is disabled as well. So when she did these interviews, people connected with her very well. In fact, I had to make sure she developed boundaries around not getting to, but people just having another disabled person asking you about your experiences just made that data so much richer. And she gave them her numbers, and she interviewed them on a number of occasions. So there were 3 interviews for each person. So she built a relationship with them. So, and in that way, she was able to know where to send people to, where to refer. She took a lot of people into these skills workshop that happens in Khayelitsha in particular. But I think for each one, it really depends on their context, whether they are blind, whether what kind of disability it is. So it's really difficult to say. What's important, policy needs to be developed. Sonke spoke about this morning about that development plan. Is it in there? Where does disabled people fit into the development plan? How does policies integrate disabled people and services? So services was a bottom line, was very important. I think even just speaking to women, we who have done research with women over a long time, we know that the research process itself, just asking women, and I think you have said it, Shahana, that just talking, somebody validates them. You need just, your violence needs to be validated. That in itself is a form of recovery, of being accepted. Somebody believes you, that's all. And that makes a difference. You don't want to go into a shelter, you don't want things to change. You just, because you develop your own coping, you know what's best for your situation, but just somebody believes you. And unfortunately, many service providers and families and friends view.
Thank you so much for those 2 questions, very important. So in terms of religious institutions, sadly, religious institutions reinforce domestic violence, most send them back, and in fact, because we know often divorce is not really acceptable in most religious bodies, they're obviously told to reconcile and work things out, or they send back to call the husband back, which actually exacerbates the violence. So I've written an article on the response of religious leaders as well. But particularly, I mean, the one I'm focused on right now is looking at Muslim religious leaders and how sort of different scripts are used to reinforce women's submission and, you know, so you're not allowed to be disobedient and, you know, you look at how you respond and some of the similar things that I think even Dane was talking about. I think that's another big area that we need to work with is how do religious leaders respond, because family and friends and then religious leaders is the next bet, isn't it, for women, to talking to them about, because they are sort of supposed counseling centers in religious bodies, and how do we work with them to respond more effectively to women and what are the options that are available. So it's interesting that religious bodies are in public spaces, some of them, starting to say that it's not acceptable, but we're not so sure if the actual responses are changing. And one of my students is actually going to be looking at the responses of Muslim religious leaders, particularly in terms of how they respond to domestic violence, not necessarily only what they say. And then in terms of family and friends, I think that we have forgotten how powerful women actually can be with other women. And this is one of the comments I wanted to make in my conclusions that I didn't make, particularly the elder women in our communities, in some communities, and particularly rural communities. And we haven't been doing work with them, and I think it's like Masisi Kumeni that did some wonderful work in Mpumalanga in the rural areas, was working with the local elderly women who have quite a lot of power in communities. So they may not have power in relation to their husbands, but they definitely have power in relation to other women. And sometimes, unfortunately, we as women reinforce some of the patriarchy to actually hold patriarchy and teach it to our sons rather than challenging it. So it's how do we work with these communities to help and to start changing these ideas, but also to create the awareness that leaving domestic violence situations is not a once-off event, because I think this is part of the frustration of family and friends is that women go back. But if they know ahead of time, they are likely to go back, and these are the different reasons why they go back, and how do we overcome those? Because one of my other articles looks at the role of children, that often women go back because of children. They think it's better for children. But at the same time, when they realize that their children are being harmed in the domestic violence situation, then they leave. So how do also families say, oh, well, you can't leave your poor children. What are they going to do without their father? But then this whole issue of, well, what is the harm the children are experiencing by being in that situation? So these things don't help with dealing with the problem of what children are experiencing or what women are experiencing. So in terms of accessing resources, other abused women was a very vital resource. So when women heard about other women who had gone to a shelter, that's when they heard about, okay, I can maybe try this place out. This is what it actually does. And some of the resources also that was very powerful for women was media, in particular talk shows. So, well, Oprah no longer, or Felicia no longer, but those kind of talk shows. So for organizations to get onto talk shows to actually say what kind of services to shelter offers, what should a doctor do, or what could a doctor do, what could a social service professional do, the details of, yes, you can go to a counselor, but what's going to happen when I go to the counselor? What's going to happen when I go to the shelter? They have no idea of that. So it's their fears of, well, are they going to tell me to call my husband, or are they going to talk to him and phone him? It's those kind of fears that sort of needs to be allayed so that they know that the specifics of the kind of offerings that can be provided. I don't know if that answers your question.
I think we have time for a few more questions, if anyone...
Good morning. My name is Chris Giles. For those of you who were here yesterday for the Institute of Child, what are they called? Children's Institute, UCT, did an analysis of the dysfunctionality of the child protection system. And I think there's a reflection in these presentations of what the problem is and what the way forward might be. In Marike's presentation, we saw essentially a top-down planning process, which is wanting to deliver more services that we saw yesterday actually don't work at all. And I think Shahida made a very interesting observation that in situations where the first response is positive, then the person who's suffering goes on to seek further help. And I think there's a clue there for how we ought to be designing our services. And you were talking just now about the mistrust and the misperception that there's a gap between the services we offer and people who need support. And we perhaps ought to pay more respect and be more knowledgeable about what is already working. I think the same point you're making. And then in Dale's point, the media are working against us. And there's an opportunity there to counter that, to engage them, educate them, in that way reach a lot of people with more positive messages. So I think some of the problems we were pointing to yesterday, there's quite nice opportunities for positive reactions to that in these presentations. Thank you.
Good morning. Some wonderful presentations and very informative. Thank you very much. My name is Mata Wohlani from the International Physicians for Prevention of Nuclear War, but I'm wearing another hat for now as a trauma doctor. There's been sporadic incidences of male gang rape where there's, in retaliation to women being raped, there's now women who go around and gang rape men. So it's a very small incidence, but it's sporadic, but it spans across reported incidences in Free State and KZN. So now, as much as it's in retaliation, but there's also another flip side whereby, how do you confirm that the man has been raped, because they will put condoms, and also the rape kit. how do you fill out the rape kit in terms of, you know, there's this other side of it. So as trying to collect evidence for forensics, how do you do that? And also and the J88 form, for instance, with being assaulted, how do you fill that out? Because there's no physical assault per se, but there's been violation. You know, so it's just on the flip side. You know, how would you see it in the sort of in the future?
Yes, Tutuzela Center, Kailich Hospital. I didn't want to answer, but I will answer you. I have seen male survivors being raped by females as far back as 2001, like at the Tutuzela centers. And many females, when they do come to us, we don't see any injuries because they are also raped by condoms or with condoms. That is an old thing. So, but then we still take evidence because there could be hair, there could be like skin cells, there could be mucus, blood cells. But then also, you don't have to see any injury in order for the rape to have occurred. And that was what we heard yesterday in like in one of the workshops, is that on the J88, you must write, the absence of injuries does not indicate that there was no sexual violation or genital, like penetration or whatever. So we see it every day with females and especially with kids. Children, very, very seldom you see injuries. There has been so many studies done where it says in about 47% of children you don't see any injuries. And that is why we spend a lot of time in court with lawyers and judges and magistrates trying to convince them that you don't have to see any injuries. So I think when it comes to the males, it's the same. It's about consent. Yeah, that is the issue. Anyway, I didn't want to ask about that. I just wanted to say that Inga van der Heyden interviewed our staff at the Tutuzela Center in Khayelitsha about people with disabilities and the services we offer. And I must say that it was very effective. Naeemah, the fact that she did the interview and that people did not speak on behalf of someone with disabilities. And after she left, I had to debrief my staff because they could not believe that she was in a position to do that, because obviously people have their own perceptions of people with disabilities. Yeah, so I think that that is effective, although it was maybe not your intention, but yeah, it did actually bring the message home very, yeah, very clearly to the staff.
I just want to interject what Janine said around the forensic collection of evidence for a rape event. I think we need to. We shouldn't be thinking about that in that way anymore, and be dependent on injuries and the J88. So I'm very glad you were here, Janine, to answer that, because I was looking for a forensic person to answer that. I forgot. Ingrid also spoke to service providers, so that's another paper analysis she's doing. And it's great to hear that the experience for people who spoke to her was actually beyond what we wanted to do. It wasn't just about research, it was about disabled people being active, being researchers, and doing and just debunking all those fears and perceptions. So it's good to hear from that.
Thank you. Are there any more questions? One last.
Okay. Well, it's a little bit early, but the session's supposed to end at 5:30, so we can stop for an early tea break, and then the next session will be starting at 11:00. Thank you.